Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very proud to present this group because they are a new group on the horizon. They've been together a very short time. They are called the First Edition, and I wonder why. They are dressed beautifully, and I think you are the leader, are you not?
Well, not really. We're all kind of share the responsibility and the blame. If something goes wrong, everybody's a leader.
Well, may I ask your name?
Sure, Kenny Rogers.
Kenny, it is a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you.
And this group has been together, as I understand, a very short time in comparison to just the longer time that you played with the New Christy Mystery.
Right. This group, as a group, has been together about 3 months.
3 months.
We've been recording most of that 3 months, so it's this is kind of this is our first tour, so to speak, and we're very excited.
Well, who thought of the outfit? Would you get
them? These were designed. We did the Smothers Brothers show about, I guess, 2 weeks ago, which will be aired November 5th.
Right.
And the designer on the show, we went to him and told him we wanted something a little unusual and yet unique. And these were the moderate outfits,
yes.
So you can imagine, you know.
Well, listen, I just have to say hello to this charming little gal here. What is your name?
Thelma Camacho.
And Thelma, as I understand, you are from San Diego.
Yes.
And you also have sung opera.
A little.
A little. You have been in the opera, civic opera groups there.
Yes.
And from that, you traveled with the New Christy Minstrels, where you met up with the boys.
Yes.
And now you have formed your new act, which is called the New Edition. You have made you have made one record on Reprise.
Well, we have an album coming out November the 1st, but our first single release, this is the first one. It's only been out for about 2.5 weeks.
Well, you look just darling, and apparently this is really going to go. We're happy to have you with us. They are playing at the Bistro up in Columbus. We're happy that they came down to join us. They will be playing there one more night, then they move on. But I hope that you will all give them a warm welcome. The First Edition.
Right.
Reason, got myself a reason.
Feeling uptight, so now just plain glad. Finding just about nothing kind of love up that I had. I had no rather no place, nothing but home for me.
That's it. We're just thrilled. We'd like you to play another number for us, but like right away. Just a
great,
marvelous new sound, but
thank
original.
You.
Very good. A new folk rock group, and they made up of former Christy Minstrel musicians, well, along with some others. They are playing currently at the Bistro in Columbus, Ohio, and you will be able to see them November the 7th on the Smothers Brothers show. November 5th. Smothers Brothers show. You do a marvelous job, by the way. Beautiful voice. A delight to have you, and we thank you very much for joining us.
Thank
and
you.
Good luck to you and your current tour. The next place you go, the Unicorn in Boston. Oh, my goodness. Bitter End, New York, Chateau, Denver, Colorado. Wonderful. Good luck to you. You have all the attributes of a very successful group. Nice that you should join us today. Thank you.
sun streaks across my room, and I'm waking up from another dream of you. Yes, I'm on the road once again, it seems. All I've left behind is a chain of broken dreams. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. Oh, I wish that love were all with me to live. What a life to live. 'Cause I've got so much to give, and it seems so wrong inside my heart that the dollar sign could be keeping us apart. You know I love you. Yes, I love you. Now this traveling life is the only one I know. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you.
Condition, my condition. Alcoa presents the First Edition. They're singing about easy open aluminum bottle caps and ring top cans.
He's got a ring for your finger, baby. Makes it easy to apply. He's got a new twist on tomorrow, found a way of making time. He's a good time.
And soft drink bottles is with Alcoa aluminum caps. And the easy way to open soft drinks in cans is with ring tops made of Alcoa aluminum.
This is the first edition of soft drinks in cans of Alcoa aluminum. And this is the first edition.
Wolverine on the newest thing.
The newest thing in San Diego.
Soft drinks in all aluminum cans. Are lighter, brighter, quick to chew, and a snap to open. Yeah.
Great Group. Brand new all aluminum cans of Alcoa aluminum.
Come on, let's keep it going.
There are guys who play the guitar. There are guys who really play the guitar. It's not easy getting to be the best, and it takes a lot of pride to stay the best. You have to care about doing things right. The Budweiser people understand that, too. They're making sure that caring isn't just a memory. And every taste of Beechwood Age Budweiser says so, and always will.
All right.
Now singing the 1968 hit Just Dropped In is Kenny Rogers with
The First Edition and Here They Are.
My condition was in. fall. Tell it out, brothers and sisters. Tell it out.
How much you're holding back on me. When you say you're giving all. And in the dungeons of your mind, who you got chained to the wall.
Tell it out, brother, before we fall. Tell it out, brothers and sisters. Tell it all.
Did you put your feet on higher ground to avoid life's mud and stone? Did you ever kick a good man when he was down, just to make yourself feel strong?
Well, tell it all, brother, before we fall. Tell it all, brothers and sisters. Tell it all.
Tomorrow just might be too late. Now is the time to get your jumbo mind straight and sneak in. Ever walk before a crippled man, pretending you were lame? And what made you think one feeble hymn to God was gonna make him call your name?
Tell it all, brother, before we fall. Tell it all, brothers and sisters. Tell it all, brother, before we fall. Tell it all, brothers and sisters. Tell it all, brother, before we fall. Tell it all, brothers and sisters. Tell
it all, brother.
On drums, Mickey Jones. Rhythm guitar, Ken Vassey. Lead guitar, Terry Williams. Tambourine and vocal, Mary Arnold. Electric bass and lead, Kenny Rogers and the First Edition.
You painted up your lips and rolled in purple-tinted hair. Ruby, are you contemplating going out somewhere? The shadow on the wall tells me the sun is going down. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. It wasn't me that started that whole crazy Asian war. But I was proud to go and do my patriotic chore. And yes, it's true that I'm not the man I used to be. You know I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. when the morning sun streaks across my room and I'm waking up from another dream of you. Yes, I'm on the road once again, it seems, and all I've left behind is a chain of broken dreams. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you. Whoa. You know we can't live on dreams alone and pay the rent. I must leave you all alone. Cause you know I made my choice many years ago. And now this traveling life is the only one I know. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you. I loved you then and I love you now, Reuben James. Reuben James. And the phrases that I rhyme are just a footsteps out of time from the time when I knew you, Reuben James. Reuben James, you still walk the pearl fields of my mind. Faded shirt, the weathered brow, the calloused hands upon the plow. I loved you then and I love you now, Reuben James. Reuben James, you still walk the furrowed fields of my mind. The faded shirt, the weathered brow, the calloused hands upon the plow. I loved you then and I love you now, Reuben James.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Right now, we'd like to invite our studio audience here in the Grand Ole Opry Hall with us tonight, and of course, everyone sitting at your sets at home, to join us in an old traditional spiritual number and sing along with us. It's, we hope, one of your favorites and certainly one of ours. I'll teach you your part, the bridge of the chorus, and it goes something like this. When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. And the second line is, when I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. And then the third line is, when I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. Ooh. You don't have to add that little ending unless you really want to. And it goes, I don't want you to weep after me.
Oh, come on then.
When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me.
Oh.
When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. I don't want you to weep after me.
Oh. Hey.
Oh. Oh, every lonely river must go down to the sea. Every lonely river must go down to the sea. I said, every lonely river must go down to the sea. I don't want you to weep after me. No, 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 no. When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me.
Sing it with us.
When I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. I said, when I'm on my journey, don't you weep after me. I don't want you to weep after me.
When I'm on my journey,
I think I was experimenting, trying to touch as many bases as I could. Not really even thinking in terms of long-range personal identity. I never wanted to be a solo singer. I always enjoyed working with groups. That was my big thrill.
Eventually, Kenny left the New Christy Minstrels, and along with three other former members, Terry Williams, Mike Settle, and Thelma Camacho, formed a new band called The First Edition, which quickly changed its name to Kenny Rogers and The First Edition.
Well, I actually fought against that because, again, my whole feeling was going into groups. I never wanted to be any more than anybody else. But damn sure didn't want to be any less than anybody else because I felt like I worked as hard as everyone else did.
Found my mind in a brown paper bag, but then I tripped on a cloud and fell 8 miles high. I tore my mind on a jagged sky. I just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
My condition was in.
I so vividly remember with the First Edition, one day thinking, we have found the secret. We will never be out of we will always be on top because we're doing something no one else has ever done. Well, you see how long that lasted.
Crawling out as I was crawling in. I got up so tight I couldn't unwind. I saw so much, I broke my mind. I just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
Kenny Rogers of Kenny Rogers in the First Edition was a very different person than he is now, as Kenny well remembers.
We had a television show at the time, and I had on my sunglasses, which were really I wore because I couldn't read cue cards without them. They were prescription glasses. And I wore an earring in my ear, much like the pirates, and we were wearing leather outfits, and my hair was probably down to about here. So I was real cute, I'll tell you that.
I hear you warm and rhythmic breathing. I take your hand and hold it tightly.
Coming up, Kenny Rogers' Second Edition.
She's leaving now, 'cause I just heard the slamming of the door. The way I know I've heard it slam 100 times before. And if I could move, I'd get my gun and put her in the ground. Take your love to town. For God's sakes, turn around.
In the early 70s, Kenny Rogers became a solo act, but not, as he tells it, through any choice of his own.
Well, the First Edition actually broke up around me and left me no choice. I mean, I was at a situation to where we were on our way to New Zealand and everybody says, wait a minute, we've had enough. And I'm saying, but, you know, what am I going to do, guys? This is all I know how to do. You know, I gave up architectural drawing when I was in college, so I've committed myself to this. And I, at that point, decided that the one thing I liked about being a solo singer, that I didn't have to ask anybody what I wanted to do. I figured I would win or lose by my decisions. And I've always been relatively business-oriented to the point that that I felt that I would get in and make decisions that were at least based on some type of instinct or logic, you know. And I was willing to live or die by my instinct and my choice.
After 9 years of leading the first edition, all Kenny Rogers had to show for the effort was a debt of $65,000, three divorces, and a confused future. So he says that for 5 or 6 months, he just thought about it all.
Is the single best advice anyone's ever given me. And he will always be my mentor.
It wouldn't be long before Kenny would take Kirby Stone's advice to forge his first major breakthrough.
I just have to attempt to see what condition my condition is.
The life and times of Kenny Rogers continues on TNN.
In 1966, Kenny Rogers was still singing jazz when he auditioned for Mike Settle of the New Christy Minstrels, a folk group.
They were looking for a bass player who could sing high, and at the time, that's what I did. And I remember Mike Settle calling me from California, and I'm standing at the Houston Air Hotel in the hallway on the telephone.
I thought he was in a hotel room with some privacy. So I said, so sing a little something. And he'd sing, and then I said, well, can you sing that a little louder?
And people are walking by, and I'd say, hold on a second, Mike. And they'd walk by, and I'd say, and I'd start singing high notes, and he would go,
can you go up just to bump it up a little bit? He said, I'm in a hotel lobby, and people are walking by looking at me like I'm nuts.
He would go, you know, this is not really a good way to do this. And I said, well, I don't feel comfortable with this either. But I got the job, and I was out there for a year and a half.
The job came with a heavy price. Divorce. Already Kenny's drive to succeed had been at the expense of two brief marriages. The offer to join the New Christy Minstrels would cost him his third.
This business is not conducive to good marriage, particularly in the formative years. I felt instinctively I needed to get out of Houston or I was going to become a local musician, and I didn't want to do that. So I left, and it did in fact cost me the marriage.
Leaving behind a young son and daughter, Kenny toured the country with the New Christy Minstrels.
Kenny was a little out of the ordinary for the New Christy Minstrels. First of all, he was an old guy. He was pretty doggone old. We're talking 26, 27 years old. And I was 18 years old. I was a young kid. So he became almost a father figure to me. We got along very, very well. We roomed together on the road. And he began to make the transition from this jazz player, very slick nightclub performer, to the folk era.
I learned how to entertain with the New Christy Minstrels. I was on stage with 9 people, and the concept of that group is that you must be a soloist who can step forward and sing. Also, you must be able to step back, let someone else step out and sing. And I learned how to put a show together. It was a great stepping stone for me musically.
After a year and a half with the New Christy Minstrels, Kenny was anxious for the next stepping stone.
There comes a point to where egotistically I couldn't live with, and nor could 3 or 4 members of the band, singing someone else's hits, and they weren't even using us on the new records they were doing. They were using studio singers or whatever. And we took it personally, and we figured that it would be more fun to go try to get our own hits.
In 1967, Kenny, along with 3 members of the New Christy Minstrels, formed the First Edition. The change prompted Kenny to transform himself into a pop singer.
You're talking about somebody who plays upright bass. And I can recall when we first put Kenny on an electric bass, he'd play it like this. And then as the rehearsals would go on, it would slowly start to come down, and, you know, it finally got into a normal situation. Kenny always had a tremendous zeal for music. He also had what it took to be an artist.
Kenny could take a song and dissect 4 parts just like this. You're going to sing da-da-da-da-da. You're going to sing da-da-da-da-da-da. You're going to sing da-da-da-da. And he could do it the first time through. I mean, to me, that's a God-given gift. And he has that gift.
Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah.
Kenny's direction led to the group's first hit, Just Dropped In.
I woke up this morning with a
The song reached number two on the charts.
Jagged sky. I just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
You get the success of Just Dropped In, and then the lack of success when Kenny wasn't singing lead vocal on a tune. We didn't take too long before we said, hey, he's the money sound, and he's what radio is wanting to hear more of.
You painted up your lips and rolled and tinted hair.
With the release of Ruby Don't Take Your Love to Town, the first edition became Kenny Rogers in the first edition.
We opted to go with my name because I found all the songs that were hits. I also was the one that had sung the songs. But it was strictly a marketing vehicle that we felt we needed an identification.
Kenny has a real good commercial head on his shoulders. As time went on, Kenny began to emerge more and more as the one you really wanted to talk to when you were doing business with a group.
When you get afraid to gamble with your image, then that means you're willing to accept what your image is, and you can only go downhill. So we decided that aside from that, we were working for other people, and that we didn't like. So we chose to leave that group and form our own group.
Kenny Rogers in the first edition became one of the biggest acts in the business, playing everywhere from state fairs to Las Vegas. They even had their own TV show, Rolling on the River.
We realized at that point that we had one inseparable thing that would keep us together forever. Collectively and individually, we had no pride. We would do anything.
Alcoa presents the first edition. They're singing about easy open aluminum bottle caps and ring top cans.
But by 1975, after 9 years together, Kenny Rogers and the first edition began to fizzle.
We got to a point to where, when we weren't having the hit records, there's an old axiom that people who feel they should be a success need someone to blame for their failure. So we started blaming each other, and we really valued our friendships and wanted to keep those. So we elected not to stay together any longer.
We broke the group up, and it was a very sad, sad last night. Nobody spoke to anybody. Everybody's feelings were on edge. It was very difficult. It was an emotional thing because here are all these people, and we all loved each other, and now we didn't speak. And that was very difficult. It was very difficult for me.
When the first edition broke up, I didn't know what I was going to do. I mean, I'd been with groups all of my life and really had never thought about being a solo singer. Now, all of a sudden, I'm by myself.
After the breakup of the first edition in 1975, Kenny Rogers, uncertain of his future, sought to reinvent himself as a country singer.
It's a shame if you don't share your love.
Excuse me, Mr. Rogers. I know it's not normal to interrupt your show like this, but the rest of your group has arrived. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce Kenny Rogers and the first edition, Mickey Satterley, Terry Williams, Mickey Jones, Thelma Pamachi, and Ken Massey.
Hello,
question. Now that we're up here, what are we going to do?
Oh, Jesus, Terry, I didn't know this when we were doing it.
Terry, we're going to wear the white Nehru jacket.
Oh, Jesus, this is... Are you guys going to sing? You're going to need a microphone.
Sure.
Do we have any microphones? Oh, let me go around that way, okay? Okay. Wish me luck. I didn't know this before.
When the morning sun streaks across my room and I'm waking up from another dream of you, yes, I'm on the road once again, it seems, and all I've left behind is a chain of broken dreams. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. How I wish that love was all we need to live. What a life we have. Cause I've got so much to give, and it seems so wrong, deep inside my heart, that the dollar sign should be keeping us apart. When you know I love you,
so this way.
Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. And if only I'm not the only thing I want, and to pay the rent, I must leave you all alone. Cause you know I made my choice many years ago. Now this traveling life is the only one I know. But you know I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. But you know I love you. Take care.
your love to turn. It wasn't me that started the whole crazy Asian girl.
News Magazine.
2020.
On a warm summer's eve, train bound for nowhere.
Kenny Rogers, from rock to country to pop, he conquered them all, and now he has it all. Millions of dollars, millions of fans, and a new multi-million dollar recording contract, a record itself. Behind it all, his own shrewd strategy. Bob Brown with a revealing profile of Kenny Rogers.
Until folk music gained new popularity in the mid-60s, and Kenny signed on with the new Christie Minstrels. But the trends kept changing, and when folk rock came along, Kenny picked up an option on that.
They are called the First Edition, and I wonder why.
He and other members of the Christie Minstrels left to form the First Edition.
Well, not really. We're all kind of share the responsibility and the blame. If something goes wrong, everybody's a leader.
Well, may I ask your name?
Sure, Kenny Rogers.
Kenny?
From that collaboration came a new line of hits. Ruby just dropped in. Something's burning. When the popularity of the First Edition finally cooled off, Kenny found himself several thousand dollars in debt in 1975. For years, he had been grasping for success, often at the expense of giving time to his two children from marriages that ended in divorce. And again, he found himself looking for something new.
Born in 1938 in Houston, he was one of eight kids. Dad was an alcoholic, mom was a maid. Kenny grew up dreaming of escape.
One of the big thrills of my life when I was a kid was going to visit my grandfather, because he had a little two-acre farm. It was anything but a ranch, but he had cattle and he had horses, and to me that was what this country was all about, a man working with the soil.
He formed his first band in high school, appropriately called the Scholars, and let it rip at gigs that paid them each $13. Through the 50s and 60s, he picked his way through numerous groups and two marriages before hooking up with the Lou Christie Minstrels. On the far side of the hill. When folk went psychedelic, Kenny formed the First Edition and finally hit the charts.
I still need some company.
Despite their success, the First Edition broke up, leaving Kenny $65,000 in debt and marriage number three on the rocks. Kenny free-floated until a special lady showed him he didn't have to sing the blues. And she
believes in me. When I met Mary Ann, I was just working from day to day and week to week. And that's what made it all worthwhile, is that she really did believe in me. And that at a time when I didn't have a great deal going, and yet I felt that I was capable of doing, not necessarily great things, but being very successful, she kept pushing me and said, you know, you can, and it was important to me to be able to do it for her as well as for myself.
When Mary Ann became Mrs. Rogers number four in 1977, his luck turned around. Kenny's sound caught the imagination of the world, and in just 3 years, his 1980s song, The Gambler, was turned into the hit television movie of the season. Plus sellout concerts a year brought Kenny so much, he once invested in three Los Angeles mansions, one alone worth $9 million. Now a simpler life, he keeps one L.A. pad, but prefers the down-home comforts of his 12-acre farm in Georgia. Behind Kenny's multi-millions is a man with a conscience who devotes time and money to programs dedicated to alleviating, then ending world hunger.
To me, one of the first God-given rights should be the right to eat. And without food, you know, without the body having nutrition, the mind can't be proper.
Throughout his travels, Kenny honed another talent, one just exposed in his book. Photography began as a hobby to f-stop time on the road, but developed into a passion.
I'm an obsessive compulsive. And when I get into things, I really get into them. So for me to turn around and get behind a camera, I must say I enjoy this so much more than I do having my picture taken. I hate having my picture taken. If you look at the pictures, I think it's a continuation of my existing personality. I think that There's a calmness and a serenity about all of these pictures that I think is indicative of the way I see things.
From the lines at a New York store book signing, it's clear many of his fans share that vision. But whether his message emerges in picture or song, the urge for self-expression keeps Kenny Rogers on the move.
It's hard for me to imagine myself retired. I mean, I have a feeling that I will always do something in the either entertainment or in the creative world, or at least I would like to believe that I can. And reality says that, you know, there is, I guess, a cutting off point where you no longer relate to contemporary creativity. But until that happens, I will be pushing straight forward.
For January 25th, 1999, Biography with Peter Graves. After 7 years together, the Bobby Doyle trio parted ways. Before Kenny had time to worry about what to do next, he got a phone call from a member of a popular folk group called the New Christy Minstrels.
A guy named Mike Settle called me and he said, "Hi, I'm in charge of the musical director for the New Christy Minstrels, and we'd love to have you sing something for us." And I said, "Well, I mean, I can do that. I can send you a tape." He said, "No, I kind of need to make a decision in the next 2 or 3 days." And I said, "Well, I can't come out there because I'm working here." He said, "Well, just sing to me on the phone." Now I'm standing in the lobby of the hotel.
And I said, "Well, can you sing a little something for me?" So he'd sing a little bit. And I said, "Well, can you sing a little louder? You know, I'm at a payphone on the side of the road and there's trucks going by."
I said, "Mike, I can't do that." And he said, "Well, sure you can. Just sing something." And so I'm going, you know, and people are walking by, and I realize how stupid that looks, so I'm kind of holding it back, and then I, "Well, it's a good day for a morning." He said, "Well, can you sing higher?" "Well, it's a good day."
And I kept asking him to sing higher and louder and higher and louder. Finally, he said, "Look," he said, "this is real embarrassing. I'm in the lobby of a hotel, you know, and people are looking at me like I'm nuts."
And I realized at the time, I thought, first of all, anyone that would hire me off the sense of that deserves whatever they get, you know. But he said, "Oh, that's perfect. Yeah, come on out. You'll work."
The New Christy Minstrels opened up a vast new world for Kenny. With the Bobby Doyle Trio, Kenny performed jazz to small audiences in bohemian nightclubs and bars. With the New Christy Minstrels, he performed all-American folk music to much larger audiences. The mass appeal of his new group and their music made a big impression on Kenny.
They were popular because they presented this material in a way that middle America could consume it and not feel that it was too gritty or too raw or too strange, but in a way that they could accept it. And I think in many ways that's kind of the real training ground for what Kenny Rogers was to become, which is an everyman entertainer.
What the New Christy Minstrels did for us was it helped each one of us get from whatever town we were in at the time out to the West Coast to get rebased into the mainstream of where the music was happening at the time, and also gave us introduction to a whole lot of people in the music industry.
After a year and a half with the New Christy Minstrels, Kenny and several of his colleagues grew increasingly unhappy with some of the group's policies, specifically being replaced by studio musicians whenever the group recorded an album and being limited to playing folk music. Slowly, the seeds of discontent began to germinate into a plan of action.
There was always in the back of our minds, "Gee, I'd really like to be doing this tune or that tune," and instead of maybe some of the folk repertoire that we basically, that's what we were hired to do. And so I think that's one thing that led to the formation of the first edition.
The transition that Kenny and Mike were about to make would put them on the map during rock and roll's most turbulent and expressive era. It would also pave the way for Kenny Rogers' path to stardom. In 1967, the Vietnam War was raging. UCLA's basketball team was unbeaten, and the Beatles released the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band album. It was also the year that Kenny Rogers and three other members of the New Christy Minstrels broke away from the folk group to form an experimental rock band called The First Edition. Kenny and the others were excited about pursuing their own musical vision, but they were also nervous about failing. Their anxieties disappeared the night of their first show.
One of my friends was Mason Williams, who was a principal writer for the Smothers Brothers show. And when we were ready to do something, I called my buddy Mason, and he brought Tommy Smothers down to watch our first performance in a little club called Leadbetter's on Westwood Boulevard in Westwood. And it kind of snowballed, and, you know, Tommy got excited.
Within a matter of months, the First Edition signed with Reprise Records and appeared on shows like Ed Sullivan and the Smothers Brothers. Booking soon followed, and the group launched their first tour.
And we had to carry our own amplifiers, and we had to set up our own equipment. Our first tour was, we had a station wagon and a van, and so we had no roadies. We were the roadies. We were the managers. We were the road managers. We did the whole thing. But in retrospect, you look back and it gives you a sense of pride.
The group thrived on its members' diversity. Kenny brought jazz and country to the mix. Other members had hard rock and folk backgrounds. Everyone found songs they wanted to record, and then together, the band arranged them. They struck gold with their first hit in 1968, a psychedelic rock song called Just Dropped In.
Just Dropped In came out. That was a huge, huge record, and very influential in the rock and roll medium. I mean, I had literally, Jimi Hendrix came in one night to watch us. We were in Florida, and he came in to watch us, and he sat through two shows, and he told us, he said that Just Dropped In was his favorite song of all time.
From straight-ahead jazz to all-American folk to long-haired psychedelic rock, Kenny Rogers was in the middle of his third musical life at age 30. The year was 1968, a time filled with revolution, experimentation, and change. It was a long way from the Houston projects, and Kenny was excited by the many opportunities available to him as a rock musician. Kenny and the group were living the life they had dreamed about while performing in the background for the new Christie Minstrels. They were singing and playing the type of music they wanted to. And as a bonus, millions of fans enjoyed it. There were, however, a few people in Kenny's life who did not appreciate his latest incarnation.
It was a real shock, I think, probably to my mom, too, to see him with the long hair and everything, because with the five boys, she's worked real hard to... she was probably our backbone of the family. She worked real hard to get the boys to be decent, you know, gentlemen and everything, and then to see him with the long hair. Of course, she still loved him just as much, but we were a little shocked to see that part of it.
The group began to achieve immense popularity, but Kenny's private life took another turn for the worse. His third marriage was in trouble, largely because Kenny was constantly on the road. His unhappiness at home was obvious to his fellow band members. He grew increasingly unhappy and irritable, to the point that the group confronted Kenny with an ultimatum.
I almost kicked Kenny Rogers out of the group in the first 6 weeks I was managing them. I said to Kenny, look, you've got a couple of weeks now. If you don't straighten this out, keep these things away from the group, you're out. Of course, I can't imagine what would have happened to him and to me if he'd been kicked out of the group at that point.
Kenny decided his career came first. He left his third wife and second child, Kenny Jr., behind. The divorce was a bitter one that separated father and son for many years. After three divorces, it seemed clear that marriage and music weren't mixing well for Kenny. Kenny tried to put his personal problems behind him and focus all of his energy on the First Edition. He continued to grow as a singer, developing his own distinctive style. Though he made a big impression with Just Dropped In, his heart still belonged to the music that had first captivated him as a child, country. It was that much more meaningful when Kenny recorded a song penned by country legend Mel Tillis. The song was called Ruby.
Thank you.
see the sun is going down. Take your love to town. It wasn't me that started that old crazy Asian war. I was proud to go and do my patriotic chore.
Ruby tells the story of a Vietnam veteran whose war injuries have left him crippled and in a wheelchair. Kenny's somber delivery of the ballad touched hundreds of thousands of people who were living their own personal agonies over the war.
I still need some company.
The song also marked the beginning of a new phase for the band. In recognition of Kenny's increasing influence on the group, they were renamed Kenny Rogers and the First Edition. The band became bigger than ever. They performed around the world and produced hit records for 8 years. Then in 1973, the same disparate talents that had originally been the band's strongest asset began to tear them apart.
I blame Terry because he wanted to go into rock and roll. He blamed me because I wanted to go into country. We all blamed the new girl, Mary Arnold, who had been there 7 years, because she didn't want to travel that much anymore. I mean, it's like everybody had their own reasons why we weren't successful.
In 1975, Kenny Rogers and the First Edition went their separate ways. After 20 years of making music, Kenny Rogers was finally on his own. Kenny made the transition with relative ease.
Coming up on CMT Inside Fame, Kenny scores with a song about the alleged pleasures of LSD. What condition my
condition was in. Everybody thought we were this big 60s acid group.
And later, a massive rock and roll letdown.
They simply started gliding down into the ground.
When CMT Inside Fame continues. The Christie's brand of folk-style harmonies had produced early 60s pop hits like Green Green and Today. But the large group also featured an ever-changing roster of new singers, with the original members holding on to creative control.
I was really happy there, except for the fact that we were only there for a year and a half, all of this. We were like second-generation Christies. We were replacements for the original members. So we weren't singing our own music anyway.
Mike had written and penned some wonderful, wonderful songs. And he wrote them, and we thought maybe the Christies would do them, and they decided they didn't want to do them. They wanted to continue with the traditional Christie stuff.
They were doing recording sessions, and they weren't letting us sing on them, which told me something, you know. So we all started saying, well, this is kind of a dead-end street.
In 1967, several of the newer members began talking about breaking away and starting their own group. But Kenny wasn't to be included. It was the dawning of the age of Aquarius, and at almost 30, he didn't quite look the part.
Visually, he sort of looked, you know, in my view, a little dated for what we wanted to do. So in order to really compete and make it look like I should be there, I started parting my hair in the middle instead of on the side. I put an earring in my ear, and I let my hair grow to my shoulders, and I wore these rose-colored sunglasses, and all of a sudden I was a happening dude, you know.
He's very smart. He's probably the shrewdest performer I've ever met, and that's a compliment. I mean, he identifies an audience and goes after it and gets it.
Once again, Kenny did what had to be done and transformed himself, this time into a hip, albeit slightly mature, 60s rocker. As a second step to gain acceptance into Mike, Terry, and Thelma's fledgling group, he recorded a cheap demo of one of Mike's new songs.
There was a sound there that I thought, this guy's got a money sound. And there was just something that I'd never really been that aware of when we sang on stage, because it was different. But when I heard his voice on tape, I thought, this guy has a great commercial sound, and that's all there is to it. We got to work together, you know.
Within weeks of their formation, the First Edition, as they were now called, landed a recording deal with Reprise Records. Although virtually unknown, they finagled an appearance on the Smothers Brothers network TV show and then embarked on an extensive club tour. They were playing in Boston the same night as their tape television debut.
I used to do a timpani roll,
And I would say, and now, ladies and gentlemen, the Unicorn is proud to present Reprise, recording artist, the first edition. And we're going into I Found a Reason, and the curtain goes up.
Can't be 12 people in the audience. And the show was coming on the air, the Smothers Brothers show. It was our first television show.
We took a TV, and we put the TV on the stage. And we all sat in the audience and watched ourselves on the Smothers Brothers show.
It wouldn't take long, however, before the first edition hit the big time for real. In February 1968, they released a record with lyrics that were totally in tune with the psychedelic times.
I tripped on a cloud and fell 8 miles high. Tore my mind on a jagged sky. I just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
I wasn't out of high school 2 years, and I had the number two record in the nation, and we were on the Ed Sullivan Show.
The song's lyrics, however, created an identity crisis for the young group. America assumed they were part of the mushrooming drug culture of the 60s.
Everybody thought we were this big 60s acid group, and we couldn't have been farther from the truth.
We were being hailed as the acid rock group of the future or something because, you know, it was real innovative stuff we were doing. But we didn't have another song like that. We didn't know where to go because it wasn't a natural direction for us.
So to counteract that, we came out with the follow-up record to that called Only Me, which went into the toilet faster than you could flush.
Floundering for an image and a sound, the first edition tried to position itself as a softer folk rock alternative to the heavier music of acts like Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin that was beginning to work its way into the rock and roll of the late 60s. A few minor hits followed, but the group still seemed to lack focus and a leader, someone who the fans could relate to. But that problem was solved when the group recorded its biggest hit with Kenny singing the lead.
You've painted up your lips and rolled and curled your tinted hair. Ruby, are you contemplating going out somewhere?
It's funny when you look at the first edition, how it is initially just the first edition. And along comes Ruby, Don't Take Your Love to Town.
Don't take your love to town.
And suddenly the album is repackaged and it's Kenny Rogers in the first edition, and he clearly was the focus of the group at that point.
Jimmy Bowen, head of Reprise Records, had made the controversial decision to put Kenny front and center.
Jimmy's theory was, right or wrong, that people need to have one person in the group they can like or dislike. Since I had found and sung all the hits, he felt it was important that we use my name. Did it create resentment?
Wasn't easy because I knew what was going to happen to me. You know, you kind of become an enigma after that. You're a Pip or a Season or a... And I really don't put that or say that lightly. Very difficult thing to handle for me.
With Kenny now fully ensconced as its leader, the group had a number of big hits, including Reuben James and Something's Burning. In 1971 and 72, they hosted their own syndicated TV show, Rolling on the River, and became even more popular. However, as the 70s wore on, the band started to sputter as the original members began leaving one by one. Kenny Rogers and the first edition was on its last legs.
Almost all of our hits, our major records, happened in the first 3 or 4 years we were together. Once the record sales start going down, the venues start getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and you only command large venues when you're successful record wise.
They simply, you know, started gliding down into the ground. And of course, the more that happened, the less interest of people in the group, the less hard they worked. And there was just a kind of deterioration of it.
The first edition trudged on until 1974. Their farewell performance at Harrah's Casino in Reno ended with a whimper, not a bang.
In the dressing room, where normally the dressing room was fun and everybody's laughing and joking around, and it was quiet. And that was our last night together. And the next morning, we all flew separate directions.
Sing your song, sweet music man.
By the time he was 37 years old, Kenny Rogers had already spent 20 years in the music business. He'd been a pop singer, a jazz singer, folk artist, and rock star. But by 1975, it looked like his luck had run out. He was mired in debt after the breakup of the popular singing group, The First Edition. He was also going through a bitter divorce from his third wife, Margot. For the next 2 years, Kenny made his living hawking guitar courses on late-night TV and playing lounges on the Vegas Strip. Approaching age 40, it looked like Kenny Rogers had no chips left to play.